Okay, picking up where I left off on the last video, I was talking about enemy logistics and supplies and how they work and operate with the logistical battalion, or I'm sorry, well, there are some logistical battalions, entire battalions, but there's also whole logistical companies too. And in each and every combat unit, there's a headquarters platoon which handles the logistics of the company. If it's like a combat company, like this artillery company right here. Say, for instance, they're doing fire missions and they need shells or their vehicles need worked on or they need food. Guess who takes care of it? It is their logistical platoon. As you can see, in this part of the city, they have a sandbagged little ammo dump where they keep their shells, powders, fuses, and everything they need for the artillery pieces to fire, firing primers and everything else. And you see up in the guard tower, they got a few guys in the machine gun, and same with the other guard tower. You can see some rubble remains of buildings on the other side of these HESCO barriers with the razor wire on top, and see these guys holding their ears, see the shells laying on the ground and a powder canisters right there. Those are powder canisters for the artillery pieces, and the shells are on the ground there. These guys are holding their ears because they're their artillery's firing. Those are the PZL or PLZ 181s, also called the SH-15, which is a self-propelled gun that's on the back of a large truck. And as you can see, they're doing fire missions. Now, this is a fire base, which is also a form of a combat outpost. Artillery can have fire bases. And when there's trouble going on outside the wire, like say for instance, this battle right here is raging, and these this tank company and mech infantry grenadier company with them, leading elements of which right here, say there's way more vehicles behind them, and they're, you know, in a column, and they got held up due to the rubble here, and they're in a battle, and they're having trouble, they can call upon the artillery at the fire base to do a fire mission. They can call in the coordinates of where they're receiving fire from. Like these partisans over here. This guy just launched a RPG at this tank. And you can see them firing back. And these guys in this wedge formation here, this is a wedge, you can tell. And there's more guys going this way and going this way. There's another wedge going this way. And this is the point man behind the tank taking cover. You can see them tossing grenades, and if they're having trouble, they can call the artillery fire base for a fire mission, and they can the FDC, which is the fire direction control, can receive the information and the coordinates and chart a fire mission and send it down to the gun crews, and then they can load their howitzers and fire at the target. And put steel on the target, as we used to say in artillery. When I was in field artillery, I was a 13 Bravo. But I got used like infantry a lot, so I've been on both ends of it. Or the same here in this situation, in this little street battle here. If these guys, if this patrol out here, this patrol of mech infantry grenadiers or regular mech infantry is running into trouble, they can call in a fire mission on these rebel positions and blast these partisans into the next life if they want to. You know, that's just how it works, you know? I mean, that's how the logistics work with these patrol bases. You know, they truck in the shells with trucks, or if there's a medevac, they call in the helos, and the helos come and pick up the wounded. Or the helos can even be the ones delivering supplies. It just all depends. The logistics vary from situation to situation. But again, like on the FOB, they can fly in their logistics via cargo plane. And as you can see, this would be happening on a much, much larger scale on the Mega FOB. This is just the Broken Bow FOB as an example, but you would have more runways and more planes going in and out than just this one runway right here. But these supply lines are how it was working downtown. You know, here's the Salt River right here. and the red zone. The red zone is like the Chi-Com version of the green zone. It is their political, military, and economic headquarters and colonization headquarters for the colony of New China, which is the former United States in the stories, in the second story, which I urge you to go back and read the second story, and you could start to understand all the things being discussed in the story. Again, these are underground, but you notice the partisans don't have any underground supply lines going under the red zone, because the red zone above and underground is under firm Chi-Com control, because they sent PAP units and PLA units down to secure all the underground tunnels and barricade them and keep the partisans out. But if you remember, a big part of the story happened that cut off the logistics of the partisans when the Chi-Coms launched a huge offensive underground, and they sent troops straight up the middle. They split them up the middle into two different pockets, and then they were trying to split them into even more pockets going east to west, underground. And above ground, they were really harrying the partisans with air power, with precision strikes from ground attack planes, and even fighters equipped with ground attack munitions, when ground attack planes were loading up the base or doing other things, they would supplement them with fighter jets that were armed with ground attack munitions, which could pull off the same jobs. Or they would send in strategic bombing altogether and pull a massive, massive, huge strategic bombing air raid, like right here. You see north central Phoenix, just north of downtown, just totally bombed to utter ruins by a H-6K strategic heavy bomber that came through dropping a mix of incendiaries and high explosive munitions on this part of the city here. And you can see the utter devastation. You can see the buildings just totally gutted and blown out and just rubble spilling into the streets here. And buildings are just craters and shells of what they once were, like a street across from this one. This is one of the only ones really standing still, but that's not to say that it didn't get hit during the raid. It's just a still photo, so it's just showing you in a still photograph, essentially, how this would have looked. And you just see the utter devastation here. They could do the same types of devastation with lots and lots of artillery strikes. This here is only one platoon of an artillery battery. So essentially, you could have 9 to 12 of these guns on a firebase. This is just facing one direction. When the firebase goes around like this, you could have more guns arrayed facing the other directions. Or facing this way, or this way, or this way. It just all depends. But they would be arrayed normally in like a circle formation of the different platoons and their FDCs that would send them down missions. And they could receive airstrike missions from drones and spy planes and even satellite imagery and other means. They could receive fire missions if they discovered a partisan area above ground and they wanted to strike it, like right here in this battle. If a drone would have spotted this, and say these guys weren't patrolling, and if a drone would have spotted these guys coming up out of the sewer, guess what? That information could be sent back to the Mega-F0B, who in turn could send it to the FDC out at the firebase, who in turn would send it to the gun chiefs, who would do the fire mission and lob the shells where they needed to go and put steel on the target right here and blow these partisans away. So, you know, the same could be said right here in this little confrontation, where you have these partisans trying to take on the lead elements of these two companies here. You could have the exact same thing. But essentially, logistics can be threatened in all kinds of ways. I mean, the partisans could even threaten the air logistics, because more toward the end, as they acquired better weaponry, they, like SA-7s and the Chi-Com version of the SA-7, which is a shoulder-fired man-portable air defense system, which is a missile, essentially. You can fire over the shoulder. They could begin taking down these helos that way. And they did, and it's mentioned in the story. But the helos had countermeasures, as they had chaff and other means to divert the missiles away. But small arms were sometimes a threat as they were coming in to make landings on FOBs. You know, they could be threatened with small arms as well, like machine guns and even rifles and other sorts of weapon systems that had enough range to hit them. So those were all threats. The Chi-Com's attacking underground was a big threat.